was very much amused that a young man came to me in a Bible class not long ago, and he said to me, and he did it with a little embarrassment, he said he had the gift of discerning of spirits. He said he could tell error. And then he quoted one of the worst heretics that there is today. I was rather amused at it. I questioned him again. I said, you really feel like you have the gift of discerning of spirit? You know truth from error? Oh, yes, said he did. I said, do you approve of the man that you've just quoted? Oh, yes. Well, then I said, I don't believe you have the gift. You just think that you have the gift. Now, the early church had it, and this could not exist. Now, today, if they were dropping down dead who lied to God today in the church, I'm telling you, we'd have a lot of funerals. The undertakers would really do a land office business. But they get by today. The worst kind of a hypocrite can get by today in our Bible churches. They're not good at coming to Bible study. They don't like that, I've discovered. But they really can exist in the church and do. Now, will you notice here, these Christians were not living on the high spiritual level of the early church. That is Ananias and Sapphira. Although they were saved, when they lied to the Holy Spirit, they are removed from the company of believers. They committed the sin unto death. There is, John says, a sin unto death. They committed it. Now, the amazing thing, and I repeat it, is that this sin could not exist in the early church. That was the holiness of life in the church. And Peter was just as much surprised as anyone when Ananias fell down dead. And the power, though, will continue in the early church. And multitudes are saved. But the church will never be as pure after this experience as it was before. Before, they had all things common. This just about ruined it. And we'll see what is coming in the next chapter. Now, will you notice? The apostles will exercise the apostolic gift. Now, I'm reading, beginning at verse 12. And by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. And they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. Now, do you note that it is the apostles who have the gifts of healing, the gifts of miracles? They have the sign gifts. They did many signs. And they did it among the people. Verse 13, and of the rest, durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them. Many were being saved. Verse 14, and believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes both of men and women. It's quite obvious that there were, by 300 A.D., there were literally millions in the Roman Empire that had turned to Christ. Verse 15, insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. Now, the multitudes do this. Shall I say the ignorant multitude, the mob does this. Simon Peter wasn't going around casting shadows. That's a business he was not in. The crowd thought, since they had such power, that if they'd just get in the shadow of the man, that there'd be something. That's superstition, of course. Simon Peter didn't do this. Verse 16, there came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks, and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed, every one. May I say, compare that to modern faith healers. They never heal all of them. Have you ever noticed that? The apostles had sign gifts, friends. No one else since then in the churches had those gifts. And when they heal everybody. They emptied the hospital. And this was the power of the early church. You see, they have no New Testament at this time. Not a book has been written at this time. And the authority must rest now with the apostles. Paul said that the church is built upon Jesus Christ. He's the chief cornerstone, and upon the apostles. They were witnesses of these things. Now, will you notice the apostles exercising these gifts? We're told in verse 17 here, Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is of the sect of the Sadducees. You notice that now? The Sadducees are still leading in the persecution. It was the Pharisees that led the persecution against Jesus. It's the Sadducees that led the persecution against the early church. And they were filled with indignation. They laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. So now the apostles are arrested for the second time and they're put in prison. Now, will you notice? But an angel of the Lord, not the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament was none other than the pre-incarnate Christ. But now he's the man in the glory. He's up at God's right hand, and he's the one that's doing all of this. That's the important thing to note. And today, he's got paralyzed hands and feet down here in this world in the church because they're not moving for him. I tell you, he wants to move today through his church, and he wants to move through you and me if we'll permit him. So here it's an angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. When they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came and they that were with him and called the council together and all the senate of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and found them not in the prison, they returned and told, saying, the prison truly found we shut with all safety, and the keepers standing without before the doors, but when we had opened, we found no man within. And friends, that happened at the resurrection of Christ. The stone wasn't rolled away to let Jesus out. He was out before the stone was rolled away. The stone was rolled away to let those out in, just as it took place here. And when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. Now, verse 25, then came one and told them, saying, behold, the man whom ye put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people. Then went the captain with the officers, brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should have been stoned. These men are being listened to now, you see. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, you filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intent to bring this man's blood upon us. Why, you have filled Jerusalem. They were good witnesses. They were real missionaries in Jerusalem. The gospel was to go out to Jerusalem, and it has. Verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than man. We're not doing this to obey you. We're obeying God. Verse 30, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. And I have you note that he was hanged on a tree. And I can't go into that. I have a little book. Many of you have it. The cross was never called a cross as we think of it today. An upright with a cross piece, a cross bar. Was just a piece of wood stuck up. It was a tree, and that's the word for it. Verse 31, him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel, forgiveness of sins. The message is still going now to the nation Israel in Jerusalem. Verse 34,